welcome back to RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C. for this first Hall of Fame All-Star Old-Timers Classic. It really looks like a great one. We've got some tremendous talent on hand, Red. It's got to bring back some great memories for you.
Oh, when you think of Stan Musial, Warren Spahn, Ernie Banks, of course it does.
You know, Jack, Ernie Banks, we're walking through the clubhouse. The rain was pouring moments ago, and Ernie was saying, we're going to play, we're going to play.
Yeah, let's play two today. Let's play two today, as that's my boy. You know, I'm just looking at this array of talent here where we are and over on the other side of that field. And by today's prices, if these guys were in their prime, Sam and Red, I think if we could just arrange to get their salaries, what they'd be worth these days, we could settle the national debt in 20 minutes.
No problem there. How about seeing guys like Henry Aaron and Ernie Banks swing that bat again, Red?
It was just wonderful, and the ball just goes out when Henry swings.
And we've got the great pitchers like Whitey Ford. Johnny Double No-Hit Vandermeer is here.
That's right, and I happened to be the broadcaster on his first no-hitter, and nobody broadcast his second one, Sam, because they had a radio ban at that time in New York. But one of the ball players that means so much to me that's here tonight is Pee Wee Reese. I think it's a shame he's not in the Hall of Fame.
We've got a couple of guys in the dugouts with us. George Grant is in the American League dugout.
Thanks, Sam. I have to be honest with you. We've had about a 20-minute rain delay, and then the big deluge came. All told, about 2 hours of rain delay. And while this was going on, I went into the American League dugout, had a chance to talk with some of these All-Stars and Hall of Famers. They're still ready to play baseball. It's going to be an exciting day. The likes of DiMaggio and the rest are here, and we're set to take a look at some great old-time baseball. Let's go over to third base and Lou Palmer.
George, the story is similar on the National League side. They want to play this game just as badly as the American League All-Stars. Perhaps a guy who typifies the spirit of baseball more than anybody else is Ernie Banks, the great player, the great shortstop and first baseman of the Chicago Cubs. In spite of all of the rain, Ernie says, hey, let's play two. That's been his hallmark from low these many years. Now let's go back upstairs to Sam Rosen.
Okay, Lou, go in out of the rain, get in the dugout. We'll be back to you in a little while. We'll be set to go with the opening ceremony for this old-timers baseball classic in just a moment. And the rain continues to fall here at RFK Stadium, but we are just about set to go. The grounds crew cleaning off the field, getting things set. We're getting ready for the opening ceremonies, the ceremonial throwing out of the first ball, and that honor will go to Presidential Secretary James Brady, who's here with us tonight. And what a picture of courage.
Person with us this evening. The first ball will be thrown out by one of the country's great baseball fans, the White House Press Secretary. Let's welcome James Brady. Bill Freehand, the catcher, is waiting for the toss, and there it goes. It was a strike right down the middle by James Brady.
Just great to see James Brady here at RFK Stadium with a marvelous crowd saluting him and the fans having a great time, too. Baseball Classic, a treat for young and old alike.
I'd like to ask Ernie Banks what let's play two means.
Bo, what I mean by let's play two is that baseball is such a great game. We all love it so much, and each day we should play a doubleheader. So I'd say it's a beautiful day. Let's play two. That's it.
The
field a little while ago, Red. I wouldn't have believed they could get this game in, but we are just about set to go. The American League taking the field here at RFK Stadium, set to go with the Cracker Jack first annual All-Star Old Timers Classic. And setting the defense for the American League at first base, a guy who made big headlines in the National League as well, Johnny Mize.
And in the American League, Sam, he became a devastating pinch hitter.
Second base with the Cleveland Indians, Bobby Avila.
He and his wife yesterday sent a message to all of our Latin American friends listening in.
Bobby Avila, the president of the Mexican Leagues. At shortstop, I can't believe this, but there's 75-year-old Luke Appling.
And you know, he can still swing that bat.
He looked great in batting practice. Brooks Robinson, the human vacuum cleaner at third base.
He made plays that were simply unbelievable, and he made them routine.
In left field, a guy who also made his fame in the National League, but also was great in the American League, Enos Slaughter.
Yes, I was at Yankee Stadium when he came to the Yankees.
A very valuable player.
And out in center field, a guy who made his fame as a right fielder, one of the greatest of all time, Al Kaline.
The youngest batting champion in history.
Boy, he could swing the bat. And in right field, a guy who could hit the ball a mile. What power, what a chest he's got. He is a powerful man, Harmon Killer Killebrew.
I don't know of any pitcher that ever wanted to see him come out.
Oh, could he hit him out in any field? Behind the plate, a young guy, Bill Freehan of the Detroit Tigers.
A wonderful, wonderful receiver and a dangerous hitter.
And a 300-game winner out on the mound, Early Wynn, who pitched for Cleveland and Chicago White Sox.
And when old Early was pitching, he wasn't wearing no spectacles, and I'll tell you that. And all of the batters wish he was, because he sometimes came a little close.
We talked to Early earlier in the day, and he was telling us he even knocked down his son in batting practice.
He told me he had knocked down his mother.
Red, some pretty good talent. Who do you like in this game?
I like the fact that it's out here tonight for us to see and to enjoy and to turn the clock back on.
Oh, some great, great players. You're going to see them all. Everyone will get into this one. The National League leads it off with a guy who a lot of people say should be in the Hall of Fame, Pee Wee Reese, who starred for the Brooklyn Dodgers. And Red, you saw him, really one of the true great shortstops.
I think it is a crying omission that he's not in the Hall of Fame.
Pee Wee working with Louisville Sluggers.
Yes, he lives out in Louisville, plays a lot of golf. And now we've got a change at first base. We'll pick it up for you in a moment.
Mickey Vernon's going in. Early Wynn pitching to Pee Wee Reese. Mickey Vernon has gone in to play first base. Johnny Mize was the starter, and they send in Mickey Vernon. Mickey working in the Yankee organization as a batting instructor. There he is. He played down here in Washington. 2-1 on Pee Wee Reese. You know, during those years of the 50s, Red, the great argument used to be about the great center fielders and the Dodgers, Giants, and Yankees. How about the great argument about the great shortstops they had? Reese, Rizzuto, and Al Dark.
That's right. I know that as far as Bill Skiff was concerned, who scouted the Dodgers for the Yankees in the World Series, he always regarded Reese as the most dangerous of the Dodgers, more dangerous than Robinson, Campanella, Schmatter, Perella, Hodges.
Pee Wee gets a leadoff walk for the National League. This is a five-inning game. The National League versus the American League. And Phil Cavaretta is at bat.
Phil Cavaretta played first base for the Chicago Cubs before he finished high school. And in his first game, hit a home run to win it.
Early Wynn throwing it by Phil. Right by Early Wynn, hits a puddle, and we've got an infield single. All right, Cavaretta beats it out with some great speed. Shortstops going at one another out at second base. Very recent, Luke Appling. There's Phil Cavaretta with a base hit. And here's the guy who got one of the greatest ovations when he was introduced. One of the greatest hitters of all time, Stan the Man. And it's up in the air to
his career, 3,630 of them. Stan Musial, voted into the Hall of Fame in 1969, played 22 seasons with the St. Louis Cardinals and made the All-Star team 24 times, a record he shares with Hank Aaron and Willie Mays. He hit 6 All-Star game home runs. He had a lifetime 331 batting average, hitting over 330 13 times, winning 6 National League batting titles.
And a standing ovation for the man with 755 home runs. Great crowd here in Washington. And Hank Aaron gets the ovation. And down the line for Henry, Reese scores. It'll be a single. Gotta tread lightly. They're playing on the grass. Have the dirt cutouts around the bases. And of course, the footing is treacherous. How about that swing by Henry Aaron? He can still hit him, Red. And here is Ernie Banks. Always got a smile on his face.
Number 14.
And Ernie, just as he did as a player, Red, before the game, even when it was pouring rain, was saying, let's play two.
That's right.
Up in the air, freehand. Comes to the railing and it's back in. National League with a run.
I would think that Ernie Banks is probably the most joyous ball player, certainly audibly so. He was always talking up, let's play two today. Today's a wonderful day to play a game, let's play two. And maybe the other most joyous player who ever played the game was Willie Mays.
Willie was slated to be here, but I'm told that he injured himself in an old-timers game in San Francisco.
Yes, I understand, a week ago, Sam.
Early win, pitching to Ernie Banks, foul back just below us. Nobody out for the National League. Top half of the first inning. National League with a run in and the bases loaded. And Banks hits it deep to left center. K-Lyons under it. Makes the catch. Cabaretta started home. Voted into the Hall of Fame in 1980. He broke into the major leagues in 1953 with no minor league experience and went on to play 22 seasons with the Detroit Tigers. In 1974, in his final season, he reached the coveted 3,000 hit mark, ending his career with 3,007 hits. Now up to plate, Ralph Kiner.
For the Pittsburgh Pirates, now broadcaster with the New York Mets.
I had to have some power to hit him out of Forbes Field. Red.
Well, at one time, though, they moved the fence in, called it Greenberg Gardens. Hank Greenberg was on the ball club at that time, and they wanted more home runs from those two. But kind of didn't need that help.
Fair ball. Robinson steps on the bag for one.
It's still an American League city. Great hand for the American League. As Kiner hits it to Robinson, and Brooksy juggles it a bit but turns it into two.
Still alert. So the National League gets a run on three hits, leaving two at the end of a half an inning of this first old-timers baseball classic. It's the National League one and the American League coming to bat.
Warren Spahn, who do you consider the greatest all-around ball player you have ever seen play today?
Well, I have to say the great, you know, it goes into different categories. And Darren, I think the greatest hitter I ever saw was Ted Williams. Willie Mays and a whole bunch of other people were all-around players. And I played with Hank Aaron, you know, great ball player.
And Red Barber and Jack Brickhouse at RFK Stadium. National League leading 1-0. American League coming to bat. Willie McCovey is in at first base for the National League. Phil Cabaretta started at the bat for the National League at second base. Red Shane Deans
currently a coach with the St. Louis Cardinals. At shortstop, Pee Wee Reese. And at third base, Ernie Banks. In left field, Stan Musial. In center field, Hank Aaron. And in right field, Ralph Kiner. The catcher is Smokey Burgess. And the pitcher, Warren Spahn, a 75-year-old Luke Appling, who still works in the Atlanta Braves organization, facing Warren Spahn, deep to left field, way back there, home run, Luke Appling, 75 years old. Boy, you gotta love it. Is that great, Red?
I told you when you were talking about him at the start, he could still swing that bat, 75 or nothing.
Luke Appling rumbles around the bases, 75 years old. There it is. Hitting Spahn's pitch into the left field seats.
Let's go down to the American League dugout and George Graham.
Luke Appling, 75 years of age, and Luke, you put some wind to that one.
Not necessarily short left field fan. I'm usually a right field hitter. But Spahn says, don't let me throw too many pitches. And I said, well, lay it in there. He did.
You've had some great moments. Is this one of the greatest for
you? Yeah, I enjoy being here with these boys. You know, you don't see them all. See a few going around old time, but never all of them together like it is here. This is wonderful.
That's Luke Appling, a batting coach in the Atlanta Braves organization. He put it to good work tonight with a home run.
Wait till the boys see that I work with. I tell them the pitch was 400 feet.
Bobby Avila is up now. Bobby had played on that great Cleveland Indians team that won the pennant in 54. Warren Spahn, there's quite a pitcher, Red.
He always was. Very difficult to beat. Won the most games by a left-handed pitcher ever.
And Avila rips it to left field. So the American League answering back as Appling homers and Avila singles. And Al Kaline comes to bat. And as Red mentioned, 1954 won the batting title. 1955, rather, with a .340 batting average. Great star with the Detroit Tigers, career batting average of .297. Al is 48 years old. A Hall of Famer. 2-0 on Al Kaline. Warren Spahn, winningest left-hander ever in the National League. Here's Kaline. Red, this guy was just great. 22 years, roamed right field for the Tigers, and could do it all.
Sam, he was a born ball player. He never played in the minor leagues. He just came to the major leagues, and his second year up, he won the batting championship. In fact, he started so fast, so young, that the Detroit fans were a little disappointed as the years went on, and he, didn't go even higher.
Kaline hits it to short. Reese juggles it, but gets one at second. Shane Deans turns it over, not in time. Here's Willie McCovey at first. Pee-wee. Tough to play on the grass, Red. Shane Deans turned it over pretty well.
Yes, he does.
And here is the killer. There's Al Kaline at first base with one out. Harmon Killebrew, who started right here in Washington with the Senators. On the ground to third, Banks. To Shane Deans, safe, pulled him off the base. The umpire at second base, Al Barlick, making the call, calling Al Kaline safe. The killer, still gets the body into it. Powerful man. Here
Here's Mickey Vernon with two on for the American League. Mickey's still a batting instructor, Red. Pretty good hitter.
He's always had a beautiful level swing. That was his trademark.
What are some of the games you remember best about Spahny, Red?
I remember so many. He was very difficult for the Brooklyn Dodgers when I was over there at Ebbets Field for 15 years. He was great. That was a great saying in Boston, you know, spawn insane and pray for 2 days' rain.
Got that one by Mickey Vernon. 2-1 with one out, score tied 1-1, bottom of the first. The American League at bat. And this first old-timers All-Star Classic. And a good crowd. It was heavy rain. An hour before game time. And a strike from Spahn. It's 2-2. Mickey working as a batting instructor in the Yankees organization. In the dirt and gets by Smokey Burgess. The runners move up. Smokey's got a tough job behind the plate. Not easy to catch.
Sam, and any catcher has a tough job. In fact, they speak of the mask, the chest protector, and the shin guards in the trade as the tools of ignorance.
I caught in my college days, Red. I wasn't ignorant now.
You didn't catch too long, though.
I moved to first base. I guess I got smart. Down the first base line, foul ball. Foul ball. And Jim Hunnicek giving us the foul sign, slips on the wet grass. But he's okay.
Well, that field is ringing wet. It not only rained, but it came down in buckets.
Oh. Hard to believe they could play. Down the first baseline. McCovey made the play, but Hunnicek was calling it foul all the way. 3-2 on Mickey Vernon. Spahny lets it go. Foul back in the seats. McCovey gives it a look. Mickey Vernon played with a few teams in his days, Red. Played here in Washington several years.
I remember I told you earlier that he had a level swing. That was Bucky Harris's characterization of him when he was playing for Bucky. He said he used to sit in the dugout when batting practice, and I just watched this level swing.
Vernon hits it slowly to Reese. It's short. Peewee's got a force at second. On to first, and in the end, National League turns over a double play to end the bottom of the first. So the American League on a home run by Luke Appling, coming back to tie it in the end of one. It's the National League 1, the American League 1. We'll be back in just a moment. And welcome back to RFK Stadium for this first Cracker Jack Old Timers Baseball Classic. As the National League comes to bat for the top of the second inning, let's go down to their dugout to Lou Palmer.
Ernie Banks, first, I've got a question. You were one of the greatest hitting shortstops of all time. How about the move when you made the move from shortstop to first base? Did it prolong your career?
It certainly did. It gave me a chance to keep my legs strong. I had a chance to be more in the game, less strain on my body itself. So it added a lot to my career.
A lot of guys like yourself who played with the Cubs, a star for many, many years, would have been very frustrated. What were your thoughts about being with the Cubs all those years?
Well, I enjoyed playing at Wrigley Field. I enjoyed the fans. I enjoyed the league itself. So it was a lot of fun to me. Unfortunately, I didn't play in the World Series, but as a lot of players who didn't play in World Series, but I enjoyed playing at Wrigley Field.
As you look at the game today and all the money that's floating around, what are the thoughts of Ernie Banks?
Well, I just missed the game very, very much. It is a big business today, and the players are just a recipient of that, and it's a lot of fun still to the players, and I enjoy being around them.
How about that old Banks philosophy about it's only money?
It's only money. That's all it is, and I know that all the players enjoy playing the game.
And money can't, it can buy you a house, but it can't buy you a home.
It can buy a house, but it can't buy a home. It can buy a bed, but not sleep. It can buy food, but not an appetite. So it's only money.
Whitey Ford, the chairman of the board for the Yankees, won 236 games into pitch for the American League. Jim Fregosi is in at shortstop, replacing Luke Appling. And Red Schoendienst is the batter. And how about Whitey? What a great performer he was for the Yankees, Red.
one of the all-time money pitchers. The bigger the ball game, the better Whitey pitched it. He never got excited. He never took himself too seriously. He was a cold professional. He, as you said, chairman of the board. He was in charge.
Red Shane Deans, way up in the air. Robinson comes down the line to make the catch. What's interesting about Whitey, there's Brooks. And Red Shane Deans, who currently a coach with the Cardinals and played with the Cardinals in great. Casey, when Casey was the manager, he used to spot him, sometimes give him 5-6 days of rest to save him for a key series, to open up a series against the contending team.
Always.
Smokey Burgess in against Whitey Ford. Burgess, one of the great pinch hitters of all time, knocked down by Richardson, and Bobby throws him out. Correction, that's Avila. I'm sorry, Avila made the play. And Vernon with a good stretch to get Smokey Burgess. Here's Hank Sauer, National League MVP in 1952. He's a pretty good player with the Giants and Cubs, wasn't he, Rich?
A tremendous long ball hitter. Always a threat, and especially with men on bases. You didn't want to pitch to him.
Now, you talked about the clutch performances of Whitey Ford, and here he strikes out Hank Sauer looking to end the top of the second. National League goes down 1-2-3. End of an inning and a half of this first Old Timers All-Star Classic. It's the National League 1, the American League 1. We'll be back in just a moment.
Well, the human vacuum cleaner is still the human vacuum cleaner. Brooks, you look good out there.
Thank you. Well, they told me in 1955 when I signed, I'd never lose my glove, and when I retired in 77, they said the same thing, so I carry it everywhere I go.
You carried it out when you went for the introductions in the beginning. You don't let it go anywhere, do you?
No, I'm not going to let this one go.
How about this night?
Well, everybody's had a great time. I tell you, I'm very appreciative of you fellas doing this game because everybody hopped on the bandwagon late, you know, but it's going to be something we can build on, and you were right there from the first, and we really appreciate it. It's been a great night. These people are hanging on everything. We do.
That's Brooks Robinson. They're hanging on what he does at third base, too.
Back at RFK Stadium, a couple of changes for the National League as we start the bottom of the second. Alvin Dark is in at shortstop for the National League. Behind the plate, Tom Haller has moved in, and there's Robin Roberts on the mound. And here with a microphone, as he always had it, the old redhead, Red Barber.
Robin Roberts, who came off the campus of Michigan State to the Phillies, he just seemed to be born knowing how to pitch, just threw a curve for a strike. Brooks Robinson hits a fly ball out into short left center field. The lights are very bright. You noticed just now as before we started. All right, here is Hank Aaron coming in on that high fly ball. Yes, he did. And of course, he's laughing about it. He didn't laugh in the regular season. Here is Country Slaughter, the old warhorse. Ball game is tied at 1-1. Fastball for a strike. Robin Roberts is still as graceful a pitcher, apparently, as he used to be with the Whiz Kids.
Coach is down at the University of South Florida.
That's right. And he was ill, I think, last year, but he's completely recovered, as you see. There's Slaughter.
Can still stroke it.
Yeah, we have a couple that can. So now we have runners at first and second. Nobody out. An error. And the line single.
Big Bill Crahan coming up. That's Robinson at second, Slaughter at first. American League causing some trouble for the National Leagues here.
Draw hung at 1-1. High inside.
Double plays, as you have noticed, are very easily attained tonight because the one obvious difference in these ball players and when they were in their prime is their lack of running speed. So if you can pick it up on the ground, you can get a force or a double play. Getting a good piece of the ball, but pulling it a little too much. He did a lot of work over there for the Tigers. He caught day after day, night after night, caught when he was hurt. Another swing, another foul ball. He's just out ahead of it.
Brian is 40 years old. There you look at Ernie Banks over at third base tonight. Spent his days at shortstop and first base for the Chicago Cubs. Another pretty good third baseman going back to second.
They have to fit these fellas in tonight, you know. Fit the pieces together, Sam.
And they've done a great job. They really have.
Another foul. Did you see Robert throw the curve?
He's still breaking it off, and he's laughing about it.
I remember when Roberts was in his prime at Philadelphia and Don Newcomb was in his prime at Brooklyn. Those were some of the great duels when those two right-handers locked horns.
Classic matchups. They may be a little older, but they still want to show the fans they can do it.
Oh, of course. Once the ball is hit, as you saw, Aaron went for it just as hard as he could, and he went all out for it.
This is Chuck Stevens, pitch hitting for Whitey Ford. Chuck Stevens, who played briefly with the St. Louis Browns.
He played for the Browns, and he played 15 years in the Coastal League. As you know, he's the secretary and treasurer of the old Ballplayers Professional Association.
Does a tremendous job with that organization. You talked about Robin Roberts, and he strikes out Stevens.
That's all.
He won 28 games in 1952, the year that Hank Sauer was the MVP. What a year he had. Okay, so thanks to that great catch by Aaron, the American League threat is stopped at the end of two. National League One, American League One. We'll be back in just a moment. Was a six-time 20-game winner and won 286 games in his illustrious career. Lou Palmer's with him in the National League dugout now.
Robin Roberts, who toiled most of his major league career with the Philadelphia Phillies. Robin, you're still very close to baseball because you're a college coach down in Florida.
Yes, University of South Florida. Lou, we enjoy it down there. We had a good club this year, and I've really enjoyed Cola. I've been at it 6 years now.
What kind of feeling is it getting together with all of these guys at this old-timers classic?
I think having it just on its own like it is, it's the best old-timers thing I've ever been about. The fans really have appreciated it, Lou, and it's nice for us to get back and see everybody, too.
Tell me something I've always wondered. In 1952, you were a 28-game winner. Hank Sauer, who's your teammate right here, won the MVP award with the Chicago Cubs. What were your thoughts about 1952?
Well, then we didn't expect to win it as a pitcher because the guys playing every day were deemed a little more viable. Now, since the pitcher has assumed a little more responsibility, I'm a little disappointed after all these years that I didn't win it that year, Lou.
How about some of the guys that you played with, guys like Simmons and Del Ennis and Andy Seminick and guys like that? Do you ever get together?
Yes, I see Kurt twice a year. He comes down to visit me, and I go up there in August. Dell's doing very well in Philadelphia. And, of course, Richie announces with the Phillies, and LaPata works in Philadelphia. They're all doing well.
Whiz kids, and this was the ace right-hander of them, Robin Roberts. Thank you, Robin.
Thank you, Lou.
Sam Rosen, Red Barber,
catches for the American League. At second base, the former Yankee great Bobby Richardson. Behind the plate, Earl Batty, who played some here at Washington, and of course for the White Sox, Minnesota Twins. And on the mound, Rapid Robert, Bob Feller. And Red, it's all yours for the top of the third. How about Rapid Robert? He had some great pitching, didn't he?
He was another one of these schoolboy sensations. He was even younger. He came out of Van Meter, Iowa, and he knew how. He's got a pitch to Alvin Dog. Fella always had fantastic speed. Maybe next to Walter Johnson, the fastest pitcher we've ever had. Old baseball man claimed that Walter Johnson was the fastest. There's no way of knowing. Men of our generation, they talk about Fella. And Fella came along before they were measuring the speed of pitchers. They had some sort of equipment that they think they clocked him, the Army engineers, I believe it was, at 100 miles an hour. But there were a lot of batters that would tell you it was a lot faster than that.
Had three no-hitters in his day?
Well, he just was a low-hit man. They tell the story one time that he got two strikes on somebody and it was getting late in the afternoon and the batter walked away and the umpire said, come back, you got another strike left. And the batter said, you can have it. I won't use the name, Sam, but I think it happened. So there's a base on ball, Alvin Dahl. And now we have Bobby Richardson was doing it.
Bobby's out at second base for the American
Bobby,
League.
Right. We have
Willie McCovey's coming up.
Willie McCovey, Alvin Dahl from first.
Talk about
one ball game.
Talk about a guy that National League pitchers did not like to face. Here's a big guy. What a threat.
In the World Series between the Yankees and the San Francisco Giants, McCovey ended it by hitting a line drive to Richardson.
I think that was one of the hardest balls hit in that World Series, Red. And Willie rips it foul. The score. National League got a run on three hits in the top of the first. American League answered back when 75-year-old Luke Appling made a home run in the bottom of the first. Right now we're in the top of the third. Cover still throws pretty well. 1-2 on McCovey. He moved McCovey off the plate here.
Bobby Feller has always been very strong on physical fitness, and he remains in shape. When he was a ball player, he used to take weights around with him. Athletes today are going to the weight room, but Feller was the first, to my knowledge, that trained with weights, carrying them on. Used to laugh when bellboys tried to pick up his suitcases.
63-year-old.
Six games for the Cleveland Indians. The original Big Mac. Oh, can he bring that bat around?
He can still swing it. Runner at first, nobody out. 1-1 game. Top of the third. Now we have one out.
A little change of pace.
And down. Pull a string on it. Look at this.
Oh, the big swing. The golf swing.
McCovey was looking for the fastball.
There's a great one. Up at bat right here. Guy the Chicago Cubs let go, went to the St. Louis Cardinals, Lou Brock.
It's one of the most disastrous deals in the history of baseball.
Now Kaline putting it away.
Kaline, who had been in center field, that's his natural position in right. He still is graceful. He still has the arm. Now we have Henry Aaron, who has a line single, who has the fielding play of the night. Captured that sinking line drive.
Great crowd here at RFK Stadium. Just exploded when Hank Aaron made that catch. What a super, super athlete.
third. They go the short way, and that's it.
So, Brooks Robinson gobbles up Hank Aaron's grounder to end the top of the third. You know, fielding was the trademark of this future Hall of Famer. Brooks Robinson played over 20 years for the Baltimore Orioles. He holds virtually every fielding record by a third baseman. And he won a Golden Glove 16 straight years, continuously frustrating opposing hitters, like Johnny Bench of the Cincinnati Reds right here. Brooks Robinson set 11 major league records, but he was also an all-around star who had over 2,800 hits. He was the American League MVP in 1964, but he will be best remembered for his brilliant fielding, his diving catches in regular season, World Series, and All-Star games were probably the best ever seen. You're watching the Cracker Jack Old Timers Baseball Classic. At the end of 2.5 innings, it's the National League One, the American League One. We'll be back at RFK Stadium in Washington in just a minute. Good crowd on hand here at RFK Stadium for this first Old Timers Classic. They're really enjoying themselves, seeing things they'd hope to see, and even more.
I think it is absolutely tremendous. I was saying to my friend here that the biggest thrill I could possibly have had is seeing Luke Appling, at 75 years old, connect with that ball and put it solidly out of the ballpark, and then Hank Aaron making that fantastic shoestring catch in center field. It made the evening. Just made the evening.
They are really having a good time. American League coming to bat, bottom of the third inning. National League making some changes. Going to left field is Lou Brock, the great of the St. Louis Cardinals. In center field, Andy Pafko, who played with the Dodgers and the Braves. And at second base, Bill Mazeroski, who will ever forget the 1960 World Series when he led off the bottom of the ninth and hit a home run to beat the Yankees in Game 7 of that series. Jim Fregosi will lead off against new pitcher Lou Burdett, Burdett who starred for the Milwaukee Braves. Jim Fregosi, colleague here of ours at ESPN, did such a fine job in the College World Series. Jim Fregosi getting set to lead off. Jim, the former California Angels shortstop, former Angels manager. There's Lou Burdett, great right-hander for the Milwaukee Braves, leading them to the pennant, 1957, the World Series championship, led them to the pennant in 58. National League set up with Willie McCovey at first, Bill Mazeroski at second, Alvin Dark at short, Ernie Banks at third, Lou Brock in left, Andy Pafko in center, Ralph Kiner in right, Tom Haller the catcher, Lou Burdett the pitcher. And we are set to go. Jack Brickhouse, nice to see you behind the microphone. Having a good time.
Hey, Sam, what a pleasure it is to be here, and what a great thrill it is to be here to watch these guys perform the way they are. They're giving this crowd their money's worth and then some, aren't they?
What a catch by Aaron.
Oh, yeah. Look at this. Fregosi getting a hold of a good one. He's giving it a big ride.
It's gone on.
Jim Fregosi, who will never let him forget that one. It just put one in the left center field seat.
We'll hear that for a few years.
Wow.
So, Burdett pitching, Fregosi hitting, American League leading. 2-1.
One more like that, and Burdett will start to throw left-handed. He's crazy enough to anyway.
Have to tell the fans, though, that this isn't the normal depth that it used to be here at RFK Stadium. We're still in the football configuration, so left field is kind of short, but the old-timers can still reach the seats.
I'll say they can. Let's look at it again.
He went out and got it.
Is.
Bobby Richardson coming to plate. Bobby, one of the greats with the New York Yankees.
One or two more like that, and Burdett will start to throw that famous spitter of his. You know, Burdett, of course, I'm sure you may have told the folks, Sam, is one of the few guys, one of the only guys to ever win three games in World Series history, the first one to do it at least. And he beat the Yankees twice in that series. He's a kid from Nitro, West Virginia. And he's facing a guy who knows what it is to handle a few tough ones now and then, both with the bat and with the glove. Bobby Richardson, who played 12 years.
had a lifetime average of 266, but he was great with that glove. Remember the catch he made on McCovey in that World Series?
We were just talking about it with Red.
Boy.
That shot that McCovey hit, I thought, was one of the hardest balls in that series, and Bobby caught it for the last out.
Ask McCovey. He'll tell you he never hit one harder in his life. He couldn't believe it.
Richardson lines one to right field. A base hit for Bobby Richardson. So, the American League leading 2-1. Richardson singles following the home run by Jim Fregosi. I was looking down the dugout, and I saw Fregosi's teammates gave him the silent treatment. George Grant is with him right now.
We're here with the man with the big bat in this Cracker Jack Old Timers game, Goodwood.
Well, it was a slider down and away. I thought Burdette would try to throw me a spitball, but he did throw me a breaking ball, and I got out in front and hit it.
What did it feel like when the fans reacted?
Oh, it's exciting. This is a super ball game. For me, it's an extra pleasure to get back and get a chance to see all the guys that you've played against for a number of years and some of the great names in baseball, and they're all here.
Good ripping tonight, Jimmy.
Thank you.
Jim Fregosi just got a home run.
Long ball man, Jim Fregosi. Up now for the American League, Larry Doby. Great with the Indians and the White Sox.
I see the umpires are rotating, but Tom Gorman's behind the plate now. You never have to worry about who's in charge when Gorman is umpiring with Bartlett, I'll tell you that. Well, for that matter, any of those guys that are out there right now. Strike one, the count to Doby. And if I've got time, I'd love to tell this story about Doby.
You've got plenty of time, Jack. We'll give it to you.
There's the ground ball. Of course, it's been pretty well publicized that he was the first black to play in the American League and also the second in baseball. But when Larry was with the White Sox, you know, most of those baseball fights, Sam, are pushing and shoving. But he precipitated one of the greatest team fights I think we've ever had. And the fellow who was the subject of an award-winning picture is out there on the field with him, Dana Slaughter. What happened was that Doby got into it with Art Dittmar. Doby was at bat. Dittmar brushed him, and a few words were exchanged. Dittmar came down, and Doby belted him on. Over to second for this one. No double play. Great all around. Alvin Dark taking the throw from Burdette. Couldn't handle it. It was off the mark a little bit, but still Alvin will tell you he should have at least caught the ball. And he had time to recover, but as it is now, they're safe all around. Doby's on. On an error.
Little low for Alvin.
A field of choice, we better say, and an error at second base.
Notice Alvin stepped on the bag trying to decoy the umpire.
Yeah, sure did. Anyway, that now brings up Roy Sievers, Rookie of the Year. First American League Rookie of the Year in 1949. They created him. He got it. 5306. But anyway, when the fight was all over, it was one of those great team fights between the Yankees and the White Sox. Now it's all over, and the fact is that Venus Slaughter picked on Walt Dropo. Now, Walt Dropo stands 6'6", a mountain of a man, and not an ounce of fat on him. He could have held most people up at arm's length and talked to him. And Slaughter, who was 5'10", picked him. And the picture of when it was all over, Slaughter walking back to the dugout with his blouse, his uniform shirt, and his pants in shreds, and his cap askew and battered on his head.
Sievers ripping
in
the left
field.
Brock couldn't get
out. Brock's glove out there in short left field. Nice try, but we're only good for one miracle catch every once in a while. So it's safe all around. The bases are full. Anyway, the picture was entitled The Battle Warrior.
There's Brock's try, just
nice
under
try,
the glove.
Nice try. No error. Base hit all the way. And it gave out a reason for a pretty good line about Slaughter, because we're able to say, well, there's never been any question in Slaughter's courage after all he's been married 5 times.
Here's Eddie Robinson.
Now, you'll notice the notes here say that Robinson hit 29 homers 1 year. He sure did, out of the lifetime total of 172. And he hit them at Sox Park when he was with the White Sox 1 year. There's a well hit ball deep to right. It is trapped out there in right field
by Kiner, and one run is in. Richardson. Doby holds at third. Long single for Eddie Robinson. And the American League leads 3-1.
Yep, the American League is taking charge now. They're out in front here by a 3-1 score.
And here's a guy who could play third base and really could rip it, Al Rosen.
Yes, as a matter of fact, when the rain was on, Al, if you recall, downstairs there was suggesting that he talk to Dick Cecil and whoever's in charge of this thing and sign a contract to do this thing in the dome this year. Guaranteed good weather.
that. Hasn't been able to get anybody out. Time to go to the spitter. What do you think, Jack?
Maybe if that's what he is throwing, you better try something else. Ball one, the count now to Rosen. The bases are full. Al Rosen, 10 years. And Al was the kind of a guy who could play hurt.
Yeah.
In a World Series, for example, in 54, I thought he was going to punch one of the newspapers right in the nose with the batting cage when the guy came up and said, are you going to take yourself out of the lineup today for the good of this ball club? He had a little sore leg or something. Al said, you know, keep me away from this guy. Ground ball taken by Ernie. Play at the plate. All right, they've got a force. Over to first. Saying everybody in because the throw went way over McCovey's head down the right field line. Everybody moves up. Two more runs are in on that overthrow. Three on the play altogether. And so now the score of the ball game is the American League 4, the National League 1. Men on second and third. And what is going on here, Sam?
A little careless play as Haller looked to go for two. Thought he had the big target in McCovey at first base and threw it high. Yeah, Dobie was forced at the plate. Seavers scored, and it's 4-1. The American League leads it. And to the bullpen goes manager Walt Alston.
Yep. Don Newcomb is now pitching. Well, up till now, this inning has kind of reverted to form, and it looks like the, you know, the married men against the single men at the company picnic.
Who started here in Washington and went on to Minnesota, goes against Big Nuke. And Red and I were talking a little while ago about the classic confrontations between Newcomb and Roberts in those great days.
Weren't they something? And of course, Nuke, an interesting fellow. There's a ground ball out to second. Throw her to first by the redhead.
Mazeroski in at second.
Yeah, that's Mazeroski. Right. He took Shane Bean's spot out there.
Robinson scores, and the American League goes up 5-1 with two outs here in the bottom of the third. And big Earl Batty, another player who spent some time here in Washington.
You know, Batty may have been one of Beck's big mistakes. He traded him to Minnesota to get Seavers. And Batty was really a throw-in. As a matter of fact, there was $50,000 cash involved, so the gag was that Batty went along to carry the money. Turned out to be an outstanding player.
Oh, yes, sir.
Ooh, look at him pull the string on that one. Now, Newcomb used to throw. He claimed he never threw a slider. But I'm telling you, he did. And it was a hard slider. It was, look at this, line shot, left field. Oh, yeah. Quick hand and grab by Brock out there. This one, it was not going to be denied, Lou.
Lou can still pick it.
Oh. Yes, sir. And that retires the side. So now, at the end of three complete innings, it's the American League 5, the National League 1.
Four runs for the American League in the bottom half of the third inning. You're watching the first annual Old Timers All-Star Classic. We'll be back at RFK Stadium in just a moment. Cracker Jack Old Timers Classic. On the mound for the American League as we start the fourth inning is a man who found perfection one all day in 1956.
We're here with Don Larson, the author of The Perfect Game, that date October the 8th. And Don, I don't have to ask you if that was your greatest moment. What I want to ask you, though, is when did you feel you had a chance at that perfect game?
Well, I really didn't know it was a perfect game until after the game when they told me, because I never knew what a perfect game was. I knew I had the no-hitter going, but then as time went on, and of course, in about the end of the seventh inning, I got pretty nervous, and nobody would talk to me much in the dugout, you know, superstition, and I don't really believe in that, but it made me feel awful lonesome, and the pressure was more on me, you know, sitting in the dugout, you know, between the innings. But I was okay when I got back on the mound, except for the 26 in a row, and then, you know, I didn't know who Mr. Alston, you know, was going to put up the pinch hit, and then I seen Dale Mitchell there. Before that, I turned around. I probably said a little prayer, you know, to get me through this. And that's probably when I had more time to really think about what the dickens I was doing out there and why me, you know, why could I be so close and then hopefully I don't mess it up. But I remember Mitchell from the American League, you know, and he was, you know, good 300 hitter lifetime. But Yogi, you know, he hung in there with my best stuff, and of course my control that day was pretty good. And then that last pitch to Dale, he said it was a ball, but he half swung at it, and it looks better to me every day.
That brought a smile out, just as tonight is.
Well, just like the balloon had burst, you know, I didn't know what happened. Yogi jumped on me, hit me, then in the clubhouse, there were so many writers around me throwing so many questions at me, and I hadn't had a chance to even realize what had happened. All I knew was we won.
Moment of history. Don Larsen, the only perfect game in World Series history.
What a game for Don Larsen, the fifth game of the 1956 World Series. A 2-0 win. The Yankees went on to win that series in seven. And there's Big Don on the mound for the American League here in the top half of the fourth inning of this classic. And he faces Ernie Banks coming to the plate.
What a game. Notice that Ernie has those marvelous wrists. And you notice his hands are working on the bat, too. All the time he's waiting for the pitch, his fingers are moving.
Great.
There's
stance.
A very high foul ball.
Al Rosen moves over.
Oh! Oh, oh no.
Good try, Al.
No error.
No.
Too tough to handle.
They wanted to give Ernie another chance to hit. That's why.
Joe Garagiola got up a good line about Ernie with the way those fingers move on the bat. He said, that's radar.
Ernie Banks, great Hall of Famer. Don Larsen on the mound. Fifth game of the World Series, 1956.
Bat handle, pop-up foul. Batty should get this one.
Earl with a one-handed. Nice catch, Earl. One out for the National League in the fourth. Getting back to Larsen in that 56 series against the Dodgers at fifth game. What a masterpiece as he won it 2-0. Sal Magley pitching against him, pitched quite a ball game. Perfect game, the only perfect game ever pitched in World Series history. Ralph Kiner, the batter.
Here's Ralph. I see a lot of Ralph, of course, as a broadcaster for the Mets, and we also socialize a little bit, as we say. That is, if he's willing to give me enough strokes in Palm Springs for the offseason, Sam. 1-1. Of course, I remember Ralph so well when he first came up with the Pirates. He was with the Cubs for quite a while, also with Cleveland. But Pittsburgh was a great moment, a great period. And there's a line fly and not a bad catch, as it finally turned out there in center field.
Larry Doby playing it well.
Yeah, he made a kind of a fancy Dan job out of that. Would have sank a little faster, I think, than he expected it to. Incidentally, we've got one hustling bat boy that I know about here tonight. His name is Marty Durkin. His dad, by the way, a great Notre Damer, is the attorney for the Association of Professional Players.
Matt Borowski fouling it back. This guy was one of the great second basemen.
You know, if you looked at Mazeroski, you didn't realize how fast he was, what range he had. His range and his execution on the double play was just absolutely impeccable.
He was the model. He was the model that they talked about turning the double play.
Right. Of course, can anybody ever imagine a moment greater than the one he had when he hit that homer in the 60s?
The glove of Bob Allison and into the seats. Bill Mazeroski from Wheeling, West Virginia, was such a great fielding second baseman in his 17 years for the Pittsburgh Pirates, but is best remembered for another home run he hit, and that came in the bottom of the ninth inning of Game 7 of the 1960 World Series, giving the Pittsburgh Pirates the World Championship. The Pirates defeated the Yankees 10-9 in Game 7 to win the World Series in 1960. Mazeroski led off the bottom half of the ninth inning against Ralph Terry. He hit Terry's second pitch over the left field wall in Forbes Field, and that set off a wild celebration in Pittsburgh that will long be remembered. Bill Mazeroski, what a great one. What a great moment in baseball history. Here's Tom Haller. Lyons went up the alley in left center. Another base hit. Allison running it down. And it's a double for Big Tom Haller, the general manager of the San Francisco Giants.
Yes, as a matter of fact, you know, Tom is a brother of Bill Haller, the umpire in the American League, and also
at one time when he was about, I'd say about 10 pounds heavier than he is right now, even as a quarterback at the University of Illinois. He had a good chance to be a top pro football player.
What are they doing? They're picking on Allison out there?
5-2 the score, American League leading it, and Frank Torrey is the batter.
Yes, they've got Frank Torrey in there now. This is Joe Torrey's brother, and I remember what Fred Haney told me about this guy one time. He said he had about as good a natural batting eye as I've ever seen in my life. And the one thing that kept him from being a major leaguer was that he was a step slow and he never could speed it up. He just couldn't, he just was too slow to make it. And of course,
got the good bat.
That's a foul. They didn't have the DH then, Sam. Otherwise, this guy might still be hitting.
Nick Frank.
Ball one, strike two. Man on second. 5-1 ball game in favor of the American League. Ground ball.
Wet grass slows it down. And Frank Torrey still doesn't have the good wheels.
No. Bobby Richardson, as slow as he was getting to that one, he had it.
All right, let's take a look at Bobby Richardson make the play.
Oh, barehanded.
Bobby can still do it. Over to Eddie Robinson. One run for the National League in the top of the fourth. End of 3.5 in this first Old Timers Baseball All-Star Classic. It's the American League 5, the National League 2. We'll be back in just a moment. Thompson hit in 1951. He's with Lou Palmer right now.
Bobby Thompson, I know you've talked about the shot many, many times in 1951. I wonder if you'll do it for us one more time. What's going through your head now as Ralph Banks is ready to serve that pitch up to you?
Well, all I'm trying to do is sit back and make sure I wait for the ball to get up to the plate and get a good pitch. And of course, I didn't do that. I took the first one right through the middle. And of course, the second one came in a little high and inside. And I decided I better swing, and which I did. The ball disappeared.
The next question is, as you're circling the bases, what are your thoughts?
Well, I was a little bit excited, Lou. The most excited, I guess, I'd ever been. I guess I was probably the most surprised guy in the ballpark, you know, that experienced the thing that happened. And I got out of breath, I'll tell you that much. And I was huffing and puffing and jumping up and down. I couldn't control myself. It was a feeling I'd never experienced before.
And yet baseball is such a funny business that just a couple of years later, you were traded from the Giants. What were your thoughts then?
Well, that's the name of the game. I guess I'm a realist, and they had a young man named Willie Mays coming back from the Army under the team, and actually they needed a good pitcher, and they sure got a good one, Johnny Antonelli. And as far as I'm concerned, Johnny was instrumental in winning the pennant for him. So I helped the Giants that year too, you might say.
What's the Flying Scot doing nowadays? Bobby, how do you keep yourself busy?
Well, I work for a very fine paper company out of New York City, and I've been doing that for the last 20 years.
What's your thoughts about getting together like this in Washington?
This is fantastic, and a great group of guys. I mean, Hall of Famers, former All-Stars, regular people, and it's fun. This is the greatest.
Good to see you again, and I know not only a thrill to a Giant fan, to any baseball fan, to see Bobby Thompson.
Well, thank you very much, Ed.
Changes for the National League as we start the bottom of the fourth. Roy McMillan, great for the Cincinnati Reds and the Mets at short. Dick Groat, the great of the Pittsburgh Pirates, in at third. Andy Pafko moves from center to left field. In center field, the former Philly great Richie Ashburn. And in right field, the man with the shot heard around the world, Bobby Thompson. The catcher is Johnny Edwards, and the pitcher is the whip, Yul Lockwell.
Never forget the first time I saw him. It was his rookie year, 1946. He was just out of the service. He'd been playing a lot of ball in Europe with the Cooks and Bakers over there. Here's a guy. And he came here, and at the Polo Grounds, he pitched against the Giants, and he had a no-hitter going with one out in the eighth inning, the first time he ever stepped out there. We couldn't believe what we were looking at. Frankie Frisch made a great crack about him. He said, you know, there should be a baseball law against allowing this guy to pitch that way to right-handed hitters.
Oh, he was devastating. That long right arm reached almost to third base.
Pitched in shifts.
Pete Runnels is the batter. Pete, who played with the Washington Senators, the Boston Red Sox.
And knows what to do to win a couple of batting titles. Makes his home down in Texas now, and he's very comfortable down there and very happy. Ball one, strike two, the count. 5-1 ball game in favor of the American League. A little different from the All-Star game up until now. Games in the fourth inning.
Bill Blackwell's biggest year, 1947, when he won 22 games.
What'd I say, 5-1?
5-2.
5-2, sorry.
They got that run on the home run. Well, the tainted home run?
That's right. Well, I'm an announcer, only missed it by one. That's not too bad.
You're in there, Jack. Runnels, who always had a good batting eye, draws a walk. And Jim Fregosi, who had himself a home run last time up, steps up. Right-handed batter against the whip.
Let me also say this. Here comes another pitcher, I think. Blackwell is coming out now. Another thing you have to give Blackwell credit for, Sam. Here's a fella who had an operation and a kidney removed and still came back to play Major League ball. Now here comes Vandermeer.
Johnny
Blackwell came within a couple of outs of two no-hitters. Here's the guy who got the two no-hitters. And very likely listening to this telecast is the guy who caught the ball for the final out.
67-year-old Johnny Double No Hit Vandermeer.
Who's that, Jack?
And that would be Harry Kraft, who's now one of the super scouts in baseball.
You can still throw it well. Johnny Vandermeer. What a feat. Two consecutive no hitters.
Nobody's ever done it. And the fellow who just preceded him is the one who came the closest, Blackwell.
That year in 1938, Johnny Vandermeer was 15-10.
Here's Fregosi. If he hits another one here, he'll demand, get me an agent.
He'll come back as a DH.
Ball one.
Fregosi played 18 years, lifetime batting average 265.
Look at the look on his face.
We got a grin.
Foul ball off to the right.
All right, here's Fregosi looking for the home run.
Let's take a look at that last rip.
He's looking for it. Did it go? No.
Ball one, strike two.
Jim did such a great job on our College World Series telecast this year.
So he's enjoying that kind of work. And, of course, he has totally removed himself from the Angels organization. I'm sure they offered him a job in the organization after all of the years with them, even though they removed him as manager. But he said no. He says, I got my horses and I got a business out there. And I like life the way it is.
Yeah, he's having a good time.
3-2. I said, what kind of horses is it? We got a few quarter horses and a couple of thoroughbreds. 3-2.
We're in the bottom of the fourth of this five-inning game. This old-timers All-Star Classic, Fregosi gets a walk.
I think Fregosi doesn't pay attention to horses. He told me, he said, I know there's a horse named Jack Brickhouse that won at Arlington the other day.
Is that right?
He says, and I know he runs better on the turf than he does on the dirt. He knows more about the horse than I do. Here's Bobby Richardson.
Bobby going to right field was always a great hit and run man. He's the number two man of batting order. Had a great World Series in 1960, Jack, the one that the Yankees lost to the Pirates. Bobby set a record at the time for runs batted in. With all those big sluggers, it was Little Richardson doing some great damage for the Yankees.
Done a lot of great work with youngsters, too.
Yeah, he sure has. Great college coach.
1-1. 5-2 ball game. American League out in front. The ball game is in the fourth inning. It's slated to go five.
I tell you, we really thought we'd never get this game in. Half an hour before game time, it was still raining, but Ernie Banks was running around saying, we'll play.
It's a ground ball. It's bouncing out of hands. Over to second. He's got the force. No chance for the relay.
he's thrown hard. Watch this. He's got a little zip on that thing, this guy from Lafayette, Indiana.
One out, Mazeroski and McMillan combining on the force play.
Don't be the batter. Outside. Ball one. What a great guy this is. I don't know if he started that fight with the Yankees, but he's still a great guy.
Oh, yes. No question about it.
And, of course, he had a managerial shot with the White Sox, and I wouldn't be surprised to see him have it again. Ball two. Runners on first and third. That's a little low. Ball three, 3-0.
Bob Friend pitching for the National League. American League leading 5-2. We're in the bottom of the fourth.
Ground ball. Moving out there to Grote. Over to second. He's got his force as Mazeroski takes the throw. No double play. Dobie beats the relay. But there was a team up, huh?
Nice play.
Grote to Mazeroski. Right. You ever heard that one before?
DP combination, one of the best. Grote playing third here. Runnels scored on the play, and the American League now leads 6-2. Here's Billy Goodman.
Well, a sweet batting stroke. I was saying earlier that one of the most remarkable things about Goodman. High foul ball down the left field side, and it is just out of reach.
Good run by Grote.
Yes. But let me quickly say this. In 1950, in that great All-Star game, when Kiner tied it in the ninth, and Cheney's broken up in the 14th. By the way, that was the other way around. Now the shoe's on the other foot. The National League has won 11 in a row. But at that time, the American League had four straight and seven out of eight. And so the National League was trying to turn it around, which they did at Comiskey Park that day. But let me say this. Ted Williams, among other things, crashed into the wall in that ball game and broke his collarbone. He was out for the season. And Billy Goodman moved in, took his spot in left field, and won the American League batting title. And you can believe the incredulity of this statement. There was actually a school of thought that said, do you think Williams can get his job back in left field the way Goodman is hitting? And there was some genuine speculation about it. How are you going to take a 350 hitter out of there? But anyway, Billy waited it out. He was nice enough to take some pitches so I could get that story in.
Drew a walk.
Well, he got my signs.
Ah, Jack. He's okay. Sam Rosen, Jack Brickhouse, Red Barber here at RFK Stadium for this first annual Old Timers All-Star Classic. Eddie Robinson at the plate facing Bob Friend with two outs in the bottom of the fourth. The American League leading 6-2. Two men on.
Fly ball foul off to the left.
Billy Goodman.
Talking about him, a lifetime 300 hitter. Eddie Robinson, pretty powerful man.
Eddie, you think not? He's the only man, one of the few men, I better say, I've ever seen put one over the roof in right field at Comiskey Park. Clear the roof. Now, it's true, wind was blowing out, but I don't care if it was a gale.
No.
That is some poke,
that's
Sam.
A poke. You said it.
And, of course, he's had a little bad luck career-wise this year. He lost his job as GM down at Texas. 2-2. If I recall, he's from Paris, Texas. He and Dave Philly.
Got it right on the head. 61 years old. Eddie, who played with Cleveland, Washington, Chicago, briefly with Philadelphia, with the Yankees, moved around in his career. Gets a walk from Bob Friend, loads the bases for Al Rosen.
Were much better than we've seen since the batter start to step in. That's a good strike. Strike one.
Al Rosen, who hit 336 in 1953.
Gorman says that one missed. I don't think Friend wants to agree with him.
Al had 43 home runs in 53. Boy, could he hit.
I think Dobie's going down to third to coach.
Right? No. Nope, he's leading off third.
He's in the coach's box the way he's sitting there, isn't he?
Huh? Oh, move Rosen back off the plate. Now, how about Al Rosen, who had that serious heart operation a while back, and he has come back. He looks just great.
As a matter of fact, there's a guy coaching at first. Here's a wild pitch, and let's see if Dobie comes in. No, it's a ball four, so he's forced in. So another run crosses the plate. And if I'm not mistaken, that is Lefty Gomez coaching at first. Now, if it is, and I'm
let's see, there, nope, there it is.
Gomez, 11, left of the super greats of all time, had a triple bypass, and he says it's the only triple he ever got in his life.
Allison right. Broke his bat, the force play goes from McMillan to Mazeroski, two runs for the American League in the bottom of the fourth. At the end of four, it's the American League 7, the National League 2. We'll be back at RFK Stadium in just a moment.
He was never known as the most peaceful guy in the world where tough decisions were concerned if they went against him. I remember hearing, I got to hear Lou Boudreaux when he was managing the Cubs. We were working down kind of close at that time, and Richie was with him, and he started to go after the umpire, and Boudreaux came out, and I can still hear Lou saying, and I'm glad he didn't use any profanity, because our microphone wasn't far away. He said, if you get thrown out of this game, it's going to cost you $500. And for that, Richie cooled off.
$500, a lot of cash in those days.
Sure. 3-2.
Richie Ashburn?
Well, you know, the whole point being, you can't do your ball club any good sitting on the bench.
Camilo Pascual on the mound. Pitch for Washington, Minnesota. Washington again. Finished up with Cincinnati, the Dodgers, and then finally with Cleveland in the latter years of his career. Wound up his professional career in 1971. Works Pascual for a walk.
Right. And there's Hank Aaron in the National League dugout. Hank Aaron, the greatest home run hitter of all time, 755, played 23 seasons. And in 1970 in Cincinnati, Hammerin' Hank reached the 3,000 hit mark. He finished his career with a total of 3,771, 3,600 base hits in the National League. And then came his greatest record, the home run mark. In April 1974, he faced Al Downing of the Los Angeles Dodgers and blasted his 715th home run to break Babe Ruth's record. He wound up his 23-year career with the Milwaukee Brewers with 755 home runs and 2,297 RBIs, both major league records. And of course, he was elected to the Hall of Fame this year in his first year of eligibility.
Here's Pascual, handy. There's a ground ball, left to second, picked up by the shortstop Fregosi, and they get themselves no double play because the first baseman, Robinson, dropped the throw.
Nice work between Fregosi and Richardson. Gives it to him nicely. Richardson turns it smoothly, but Robinson can't handle it. So the game stays on. Here it is again. Papko going up the middle. Fregosi gets to it nicely. Pretty play. And Robinson can't handle it.
Papko at first picked Roth to the bat. You learn something all the time. I didn't realize
Papko was the guy in left field when Bobby Thompson hit that home run to beat the Dodgers in 51.
Oh, can't you just see that picture of helpless dejection as Andy stood there on that wall?
I talked to Andy before the game. He said, you know, I still dream about it to this day.
Dick Groat, great shortstop for the Pittsburgh Pirates. Two outs here in the fifth inning. 7-2, the American League leads it.
So it takes the old-time American League leaguers to break the streak, huh?
I guess they're picking up where they left off in their day. 2-2. Notice how that outfield is playing respectfully deep for Mr. Groat. Ever since Appling hit when everybody's backed up out there.
What a way to start this game off. In the bottom of the first, 75-year-old Luke Appling hitting a home run. Good crowd. There you see the outfield.
There they are.
Allison, Dobie, and Goodman. 2-2.
Growth.
And run to the bottom half of the fifth inning as the National League takes the field. The end of 4.5. It's the American League 7, the National League 2. We'll be back with more of the first annual Old Timers All-Star Baseball Classic in just a moment. And Jack Brickhouse, Red Barber, along with George Grand and Lou Palmer in the dugouts. Happy to be bringing you this Old Timers All-Star Classic on the mound for the National League. Hoyt Wilhelm, who pitched until he was 49 years old.
That's right, and he's got so many records we can't go into them right now. From the standpoint of the number of games played, the number of pitches thrown, the number of knuckleballs thrown, but I want to tell you something about this guy, and I'm glad they're playing the last half of this inning, even though the American League has got the ball game wired up, because after all, it's a chance to see all the stars this way. But the knuckleball itself, of course, is one of the most interesting pitches in the history of the game. It drives people crazy. It drives umpires goofy. It drives batters goofy. And it mostly drives catchers crazy, too, especially in those days when they had to catch it with the smaller mitt, Sam. And you right here in Washington, one time, you had four knuckleball specialists. You had Dutch Leonard, Johnny Nageling, and Mickey Hefner, and Roger Wolf. I know the old-timers will remember that. And the two catchers were Rick Farrell and Jake Early. And the gag was, of course, that Jake was inducted into the Army, and he was probably the most willing inductee of his day. He was so glad to get away from those knuckleballs.
Bob Rogers hitting it down to McCovey, who pulls it out of the mud around first base and makes the tag for the out. Hoyt Wilhelm, 59 years old, pitched until 1972. Here's McCovey pulling one out of the mud and tagging out Bob Rogers. Here's Chuck Hinton.
Chuck is with the recreational department up here in Washington, I understand now. Yeah. We were talking before the ballgame. I said, I just want to know one thing. Do you have to be either a Republican or a Democrat? Is this civil service? He says, I think it's civil service. I think we're all right.
Chuck's a local favorite. Hoyt Wilhelm delivers back up here.
You know, remember Bobby Uecker's description of how to handle a knuckleball? He said, you just wait till it stops rolling and then pick it up.
That's a tough pitch to handle for batters and catchers. And this is the man who made them make
the big glove.
Yeah, the glove for a while there got to be about the size of, they call it the giant pizza.
People remember him best as a great relief pitcher, but he was a pretty good starter too. McMillan at short. Good stretch by McCovey, and Chuck Hinton is retired.
So that's two out, one more, and history has been made at RFK Stadium in Washington, so far as we're concerned, I think, Sam.
I tell you, the fans,
as far as
here,
a lot of people, with all that terrible rain,
wow,
all that holdup, look at the crowd we have here tonight. We don't have a figure on it, but it's got to be well up into the 20s. Well
up in
there.
What a tribute to the fans here.
Oh, we might have had 35 or 40,000 for
no
this
question,
one with a real good night.
And the fans have been into it. They've been cheering the players in batting practice before the rain started. They were out early cheering all the players.
Well, our congratulations to Dick Cecil and Tal Smith, the guys who did all the hard work, not all the hard work, but spearheaded the hard work, yep, by so many other people on this. And our thanks to Cracker Jack,
for putting it all together.
For, after all, that relationship they have with baseball through the song, of course, has made them a natural for this type of sponsorship. And, of course, the benefit to the old-time ball players is just so important.
Wilhelm to Fregosi up high. It's 1-2 with two outs here in the bottom of the fifth. American League leading it 7-2.
I'll never forget, going back to Wilhelm being the great relief pitcher, but as a starter, I'll never forget him no-hitting the New York Yankees.
Yes.
With that flutter ball and all the big Yankee hitters, Mantle, Maris, Berra, all going up there and just waving at that flutter ball going by, and Wilhelm pitching the no-hitter.
Hey, one time, didn't they down in Baltimore when he was there have a catch Hoyt Wilhelm's knuckler contest for the fans? Anybody who wanted to try it?
I think so.
Yeah, he drove half of those people out of their minds.
Here's something.
Here's Hoyt. Remember the great Dutch Leonard line with, I forget who the umpire was, might have been Moriarty. Dutch threw the famous knuckleball, and he was an easy guy to live with, but with the bases full and 3-2, he split the plate with his, and the umpire said ball four at a tough ball game.
And Dutch walked down to him and he said, and for Dutch, this was an outburst, he said, "Don't you think that ball caught a piece of the plate?" The umpire said, "You know, Emil, I wouldn't be surprised if it did. It's been every place else in the ballpark."
Fregosi wanted to stay up at bat. Instead, they wave him on to first base with ball four and keeps things going. Bobby Richardson will come to the plate.
And these players have had a great time. I mean, they really wanted to play. They were all disappointed sitting around the clubhouse during the rain that preceded the game, the downpour, really.
Thunder and lightning, and there's a base hit for Richardson. Hit.
They all wanted to play. As they sat around, they were just hoping it would let up and waiting for any optimistic word, and finally it stopped, and here we go. And a great, great tribute to these players.
This is Dobie again. Unofficial attendance, 29,196.
And that, again, as Jack mentioned, a downpour an hour prior to the game, and up till about 15 minutes before game time, it was still raining, and a great turnout. Dobie on the
Look
ground.
Out.
Mazeroski
out.
Waits for it to stop. And that's it. And everybody out of the dugout. And everyone on their feet here at RFK Stadium as baseball returns to Washington for the first time in 11 years.
And there's Chuck Stevens, one of the happiest guys in the world. He's got a right to be. He's one of the hard workers in this affair, too. And he even suited up for the game.
What a tribute to these great, great players. Hall of Famers, All-Stars, young old-timers, old-old-timers, Earl Batty right there, Stan the Man Musial, Hank Aaron, Warren Spahn,
Harmon Killebrew, Bill Freehan. There they are, Killebrew looking this way.
And a standing ovation from this crowd of around 30,000. And guaranteed, Jack, as you said, there's Bob Rogers. If it had been good weather all the way, we'd have gotten over 40,000.
Easily.
Just great. This first.
Well, Al Lopez finally beat Walson in an important ball game.
Al Lopez, the manager of the American League, and Walter Alston, the manager of the National League. A great, great game won by the American League 7-2. Jack Brickhouse, Red Barber, and I will be right back at RFK Stadium in just a moment.
Jack, Old Timers Baseball Classic is history, and everyone goes home happy after seeing a wonderful array of stars put on a great show. Right now, George Grand is with the managers.
Well, you two guys finally met up once again, Walt Alston and Al Lopez. Results a little bit different. I know you're pretty happy, Al.
Very happy. I thought it was quite a show. I think they really enjoyed. I think the fans enjoyed it very much.
What a night, Walt.
You know, there were great plays on both sides. And those guys hit the ball better than I thought anyone could hit it, you know? Anyway, we're in the same clubhouse. I'm going to drink some of his champagne.
Congratulations, guys. Let me ask you, do you have anything you want to say to the American League managers for the All-Star game now?
Well, those guys better. You know, if they don't win next year, I think we might end up playing that ball game instead of the young guys.
Okay, Al Lopez and Walt Alston, they had their fun here tonight, as did everybody at RFK Stadium.
You said it, George. A great time. The American League defeats the National League 7-2 in the first Old Timers Baseball Classic. I'll be back with a final word right after this.
Take me out to the ball game.
Great memories will come out of this first Cracker Jack.